I probably should have paused them from going to say it
to me. Yeah, they were. Berkeley County.
It's kind of predictable as well.
Yeah. I think the same way. His little sister Sarah's excited. Go back. I don't know if Matthew and Laura are very excited to go back.
It picks up.
Is Barrington right on the base?
Yeah. Morning, guys. Good to see you. Hey, how are you guys doing? There you go.
Do you live right on the base?
No, I don't.
I didn't choose your seat.
Okay.
Yeah.
that one last time we saw each other, that you were there after. That's all we're going to do. That's such a long time.
Semper Fi, Marine Corps.
Everybody, and welcome to this gathering of Trinity Church. We're grateful that you are here, decided to worship together this morning. If you don't normally worship with us, we'd love to have a chance to get to know you. You can fill out a connection card on our website, trinitycharleston.org. Let us know if there's any way that we can keep in touch with you or pray for you. We would love to know that. Also, you can give through our site or at the table over here, just on your way in or out of the service. We don't take an offering during the service. We do know that giving is an important part of our discipleship in terms of what it means to follow Christ. Just one announcement as we begin. Kimmy and Stephen are away on their baby moon this weekend. That's not the announcement. The announcement is that on August 30th, we are having a shower for Kimmy. And that'll be at our house at 6:30 p.m. That's in the emails that go out too. And so you can sign up for those on the website as well, but we'd love to have you join and celebrate in God's goodness to them and the expansion of their family. One other thing I wanted to mention is over at the table, actually kind of like with all the stuff here, we have these little cards, and I just use these to invite people to church. I give these out regularly.
just in terms of as I talk with people and I just let them know who I am. It's easy for me because people ask me what I do and they're like, you're a pastor. And so I tell them, and it's nice too because people know where the mall is. And I just wanted to encourage you to carry these with you as a way of inviting people and including them as a way of sharing the gospel with them. Hopefully you get that chance personally, but if you don't, you can bring them here and know that they will hear it here as part of our worship together. Well, our call to worship this morning is from Deuteronomy 32, a prayer of Moses, verses 3 and 4. For I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Ascribe greatness to our God. The rock, his work is perfect. For all his ways are justice, a God of faithfulness, and without iniquity, just and upright is he. It's good to know that we have a God we can depend on, build our lives on. This text and our first song calls to do this, to build our life on Christ, the solid rock. Would you stand, please? We'll sing together.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. High and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Amen. You can have a seat.
This morning we come to confess to the Lord together, so please pray along with me. Father, we confess
that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have failed to love you with our whole heart and to love our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Well, our assurance of pardon this morning comes from Romans 5:1. It says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And this kind of reminds me of a Puritan pastor named Richard Sayers. He says that there is more mercy in Christ than there is sin in us. And that's a sweet, sweet word of reminder. Sweet word of assurance. So let's stand and sing His Mercy as well.
Actually, you can stay seated because we haven't sung this actually. I know a lot of you know this, or some of you do anyway, but we haven't sung it at Trinity. And so I'm just going to sing through the first verse and chorus with these guys, and then we're going to go back through, stand up. We won't stop. We'll have you stand and we'll sing the first verse again. So we'll go through and then back to the beginning.
Mercy is more. Keep us day and night. We can
God. Can you have a seat?
Well, our scripture reading this morning comes from 1 Samuel 1 and Acts 25.
Today's scripture reading comes from 1 Samuel chapter 1, 21 through 28. This is where Samuel's parents provide a good example of prayer, faithfulness, and sacrificial giving. When the man Elkanah went up with all his family to offer an annual sacrifice to the Lord and to fulfill his vow, Hannah did not go. She said to her husband, "After the boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always." "Do what seems best to you," Elkanah said. Her husband said to her, "Stay there until you have weaned him. Only may the Lord make good his word." So the woman stayed at home and nursed her son until he had been weaned. After he was weaned, she took the boy, young as he was, along with a three-year-old colt, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord at Shiloh. When they had slaughtered the bull, they brought the boy to Eli. And she said to him, "As surely as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. I prayed for this child, and the Lord has granted me what I ask of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life he will be given unto the Lord." And he worshiped the Lord there. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is Acts 25. 3 days before arriving in the province, Festus went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem, where the chief priests and the Jewish leaders appeared before him and presented the charges against Paul. They requested Festus, as a favor to them, to have Paul transferred to Jerusalem, for they were preparing an ambush to kill him along the way. Festus answered, "Paul is being held at Caesarea, and I myself am going there soon. Let some of your leaders come with me, and if the man has done anything wrong, they can press charges against him there." After spending 8 or 10 days with them, Festus went down to Caesarea. The next day, he convened the court and ordered that Paul be brought before him. When Paul came in, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him. They brought many serious charges against him, but they could not prove them. Then Paul made his defense. "I have done nothing wrong against the Jewish law or against the temple or against Caesar." Festus, wishing to do the Jews a favor, said to Paul, "Are you willing to go to Jerusalem and stand trial before me there on these charges?" Paul answered, "I am now standing before Caesar's court, where I ought to be tried. I have not done any wrong to the Jews, as you yourself know very well. If, however, I am guilty of doing anything deserving death, I do not refuse to die. But if the charges brought against me by these Jews are not true, no one has the right to hand me over to them. I appeal to Caesar." After Festus had conferred with his council, he declared, "You have appealed to Caesar. To Caesar you will go." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our sovereign God orchestrates all the things that go on in our lives. And we don't know exactly what he leads us to do, but honestly, he leads us to glorify him, and that's the primary thing. And so we stand together and we sing to the Lord now.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. the sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Father, I thank you that we can come to you today in the knowledge that you care for us, that you have loved us, that you have called us from darkness to light, that as a good father, you have compassion on us. Lord, and what child, if he asks his father for bread, would get a stone, or for a fish, we'll get a serpent. We know that every good gift comes from you, that we can trust your character, we can trust your goodness and your love. And so this morning we come to you gladly as your children. We ask, Father, that you'll hear us. We ask that you would answer us, Lord, that you would meet our needs, give us eyes to see Christ, to see you at work in our world, to understand what it means to be a child of God. Father, this morning we pray for one of our local churches here, for Grace on the Ashley Baptist Church, and for Pastor Greg Smith. Lord, I pray for them that you would build them up in faith in Christ's likeness, that they would know your goodness and trust your care. that they would cherish the gospel, that it would change them. And we ask as well today, Father, for the spread of the gospel in Pakistan, a country dark and yet where the light is spreading. Lord, we pray for your protection on families there, for those who are being kidnapped or forced to convert. Lord, I pray that you would protect the church, that they would be courageous, Lord, even as we see Paul here, that they would not be ashamed, that they would be willing to suffer for the sake of the gospel. But also, Lord, that you would be merciful, and God, that you would convert hearts and draw them to Christ. We ask as well today for South Carolina Governor Henry McMaster. Lord, I pray that you would give him wisdom, that your spirit would guide him as you move in the hearts of kings, and Lord, that he would know your grace and your care. We think of Michael and Amy. Father, is there a way, Lord, would you give them safety in their travel, even as they process all this means for their family? Lord, would you encourage them and help them know your care? And we think of Eliza Jane as well. I pray that she would grow and flourish as a student and also as a Christian and as our sister in Christ. And Lord, give her a good church that can encourage her in her faith there in Louisville as well. Thank you for Terry, Father. I thank you for her life and her friendliness, her desire to reach out, to pray, to encourage others. Lord, we pray that you will bless her on this, her birthday. And we thank you that her family can be here too. God, we pray that you would encourage them in their time here with us. We pray for Wanda and the friends and family, Lord, of Fran as she passed unexpectedly this week. Lord, would you comfort them with the comfort that only you can give, a comfort that ministers to us in our sorrow. And now as we come to your word, Father, I pray that you will make us a congregation that loves and disciples our children, as we saw in Hannah and Elkanah, as they did for Samuel, and as we see here for Timothy, as his mother and grandmother do for him, Lord, that we'll do this. That we as your children will also remember what is ours in Christ, all that you've given to us, that we'll look back to what he has done and also look forward to what he will do in his return. Lord, that you'll help us be faithful and committed in our friendships for the sake of the gospel. That we will love and serve and care for one another. That this kind of loving care would be a part of what it means to be a part of Trinity Church. So, Father, I pray that you'll open our eyes to see as we look into your word today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you to open your Bibles with me to 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1. We are in a whole new book this morning, but it's right after where we were last week. We finished 1 Timothy, and now we are in 2 Timothy, and we're going to walk our way through this chapter this morning. As we do this, we're going to look here at what it means to be refreshed in Christ, and particularly how it is that God works this ministry of refreshment in Paul's life, whether it's through the gospel itself, whether it's through relationships that come to us through the gospel, but how God refreshes us through Christ. As we do this, we're going to see this central truth, that remembering what God has given us through Christ refreshes our souls in Christ. Remembering what God has given us through Christ refreshes our souls in Christ. Well, 2 Timothy, ironically enough, is Paul's second letter to Timothy. We just finished his first letter. But not only is this his second letter to Timothy, it's likely the very last thing he writes. It's not really his last will and testament, but for our purposes, it really could be. He's rotting in a Roman prison. Casey read for us a little while ago, kind of the first step in that process as he appealed to Caesar. He's eventually, and now, he is in a Roman prison. Well, Paul met Timothy on his second missionary journey. He's traveling throughout the world of the Bible at this time, not really through Palestine, but kind of through the whole Central or Asia area there. And it comes to Derbe and Lystra in the middle of this journey. And Lystra here is probably where he meets Timothy. It's in these two towns, and they're just relatively close to each other. So this is Acts 18. He travels on. Eventually, he comes to the city of Ephesus. And here in Ephesus and Lystra, we've got a unique connection because Timothy, who's from Lystra, Paul picks him up. He takes an interest in Timothy. And on his second journey, he spends just a little bit of time in Ephesus, not really that long. But as you know, Paul traveled throughout the known world then, throughout this area, a number of times. And on his third missionary journey in Acts chapter 19, he stops in Ephesus again. So on his second trip, he was there just a little bit of time. But on his third trip, he stays there for over 2 years, for 27 months. And as he's there, he invests in the church, he makes disciples, and he builds the church up there. And it's here with this body of believers that he knows well, he spent a lot of time there, that he later sends Timothy, his son, his child in the faith, to become the pastor. Well, Paul now sits on death row. And he's sitting here, and this background of Paul's relationship with Timothy brings us to his greeting to Timothy. And as he greets Timothy, the first thing he does is he calls him to remember what he's been given in Christ. Remember what he's been given in Christ. So if you have a copy of God's Word there, we're going to read the first seven verses of 2 Timothy chapter 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, according to the promise of the life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you that I may be filled with joy. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Well, it's been several weeks since we looked at it, but Paul's greeting in 2 Timothy is strikingly similar to his greeting in 1 Timothy. In fact, I thought I would throw it up here so you can kind of see it side by side. But I imagine if I'm Timothy and I'm getting the second letter, it's like, hey, I think I've heard this before. Because it's not quite word by word, but it is pretty much line by line. He greets Timothy in the same way. Paul, an apostle, by the will of God, through Christ. And so he greets Timothy, and he calls him the same thing. He calls him his true child, and now his beloved child in Christ. Well, Paul claims apostolic authority from God in verse 1, and then he highlights for Timothy and for us what is ours in Christ. And in doing so, he sends him greetings, grace, mercy, and peace to his beloved child from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, verses 3 through 7 use a series of synonyms to communicate something important. They're synonyms that communicate the same idea that we should remember. So look in verse 3. He says, I remember you constantly in my prayers. Verse 4, I remember your tears. Verse 5, I am reminded of your sincere faith. Verse 6, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God. Well, what is it that memories do for us? Why is it so important that we remember? Well, memories can be difficult things. They can also be sweet things. And used well, memories push us toward what is most important. This last week, I was riding in my car with one of my kids, and they said to me, Dad, what is your strongest memory before you turn 10? And I'm like going through things in my mind. I'm like, I don't remember that much before I turned 10. Well, what about 12? I'm like, okay, well, that expands a little bit. And you know, as I thought back, I mean, the first thing that popped to my mind was when I was 14. Because when I was 14, lightning strike caused our house to burn. Such a vivid memory that popped into my mind very quickly. I mean, it was a traumatic event. But then as I thought back further, when I was 7, our family moved from one house in the city to a house in the country, and I remembered that quite vividly. Well, these strong memories teach us. They teach us about the things that have impacted us. And remembering those things kind of draws our minds to the things that are both important to remember, and they also tell us things about the things that have shaped our lives. And over time, I don't know if you had this experience, I often forget some of the worst things that have happened to me. You know, there are times I look back and I'm like, that was so amazing. And then if I actually think about what actually happened, it wasn't that great, but in my memory, it's pretty good. Because over time, I don't know, just God graciously allows the joys to outnumber the sorrows. And Paul remembers three specific things here. First, he remembers his own relationship with Timothy. He tells us two things that he remembers specifically about Timothy. Timothy's fear, tears, and Timothy's faith. His tears and his faith. And these memories, then as he remembers this, they move Paul to pray for Timothy. I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. These tears are probably Timothy's parting from Paul, the sweet relationship and the breaking off of this relationship. And the memories of this motivate Paul to pray for Timothy in love, to long to see him face to face, in the hope of seeing Timothy in person, face to face, gives Paul the hope of being filled with joy. Now, ironically, we sit here and we know there's some things that Paul doesn't know. Paul won't see Timothy again. At least in this life, he will one day in heaven, but they're not going to meet again face to face. But there's something about physical presence that brings joy in a way that letters, in our world, texts, phone calls, even FaceTime cannot. You know, we live in a world where our presence is a lot closer than Paul and Timothy, just in terms of how we can approach one another. When we can see someone's face like that, they can live on the other side of the world, and we can talk to them in real time and see their face and see them moving, but there's still something different about sitting with that person in the same room and talking to this person, being able to physically touch and hug or hold that person. I mean, this happens when families are apart. You know, someone goes on a trip, or parents and grandkids, and you know, in our world, we love FaceTime, but we know that's not really, I mean, it's kind of face-to-face, but it's not really face-to-face. Because there's something about that presence in the relationship. And Paul's memories of Timothy bring joy because of the joy that face-to-face those memories bring to Paul. And in particular, he remembers Timothy's sincere faith. And he tells us here where Timothy gets this faith from. He remembers Timothy's relationship with his family. So he calls Timothy his child in the faith, but now he remembers Timothy's actual mother and his grandmother. Why does Timothy believe the gospel? Well, there are different kind of levels that we can answer this question. I mean, one way we can answer it is in verse 9, God saved Timothy by his own purpose and grace before the world began. So there's one way we can look at it that is from the divine perspective. We also know that Timothy placed faith in Christ. He repented and believed. So there's this moment in time when Timothy becomes a follower of Christ. So we could look at it in terms of his decision. But again, why? Why does he make that decision? Why does he place his faith in Christ? Well, look again at verse 5. I am reminded... of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. So it is Timothy's faith, and yet it's the same faith that Eunice and Lois have. It comes now to Timothy through two key people, his mom, his grandma. Well, the International Bible Society tells us that 83% of people who place their faith in Christ will do so between the ages of 4 and 14. Now, it tells us that 17% of people do that outside that window, but 83% of people do it as children. I mean, the most fruitful mission field for making disciples is sharing our faith with our children. Now look, God saves people of all life stages, of all backgrounds. But we have a unique opportunity with children. Now the unique life stage of our church means we don't have a ton of people in like one demographic category. In other words, we don't have like a married with kids class and a married without kids class. But we have people who are in grandparent stage. We have people who are in parenting with kids stage. We have expecting parent stage. We have married and not expecting and not wanting kids stage. And we have single and not thinking about it stage. But what we see here is that the practice of passing on faith to our children is a core part of what it means to be a follower of Christ. So we enjoy having children as part of our worship service. So we seek to read the Bible with our children at home. And you might be thinking, well, okay, that's easy for you to say because you got kids, you can read the Bible with them, and they're sitting here. But I don't have kids. I'm not married, and I don't have any plans, projections to be married anytime soon. But here's the thing. Who does Christ give discipleship to? I mean, yes, there's a responsibility of families, but he gives it to the church. It's what it means to be a part of a church, what it means to be a Christian. We exist. If you are a follower of Christ, you exist to lead other people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. Discipleship isn't something that belongs to a few people, to pastors, to deacons, to elders, to parents. It's something that belongs to all Christians to lead people to follow Christ. To be a disciple is to call people to be disciples. So what do? We look for someone, anyone, of any age, and see if you can lead them one step closer to Jesus. And this brings us to remembering God's gift to Timothy. Now, I'm not much of a camper, as in I don't camp out much. Some people here, like the Perrys, you know, can do it for days on end and somehow survive. You know, others of us, you know, live more sheltered lives indoors. But I have built a fire or two in my life. Sometimes inside, sometimes outside. And in our house now, we don't have a wood-burning stove. We flip on a switch and the fire comes on, and we flip it off and it goes off. It's a gas fireplace. But a previous house had a wood-burning fireplace in it. And there's something heartwarming about the warmth, the crackle and pop of the wood in the fire. And what happens is, if you don't have kind of the eternal source of gas feeding the flame, you have to feed the fire itself, right? And so one of the things that you do is you tend the fire. So sometimes you feed it more wood. Sometimes, I don't know, if you're sleeping or maybe you've been talking for a while, or you're out of the room, you come back, and all that's left is the ashes. But if the fire has been burning recently, among those ashes are coals. And how is it that you take those coals and build them back into an actual fire? You kindle the flame. You bring other little bits of fuel and you might blow softly on those coals. If you have some sort of bellows, you might use that to provide, because the more air, the more oxygen they get, the hotter the coals get. You blow, you feed it, and you kindle, you fan it back into flame. You can take a fire that's almost out, and you can build a raging inferno from just a few coals. And this is the very language that we see Paul using here in verse 6. For this reason, he says, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. You can't imagine. I mean, what a thing to be ordained as a gospel preacher by Paul. I mean, like, it's one thing to be, like, set apart for ministry. It's another thing when that apostle does it. I mean, he's the apostle. I mean, we've got the surviving disciples. But as we come, like, really, he becomes the missionary to take the gospel throughout the world, and he's the one who lays his hands on you. I mean, I can imagine what a moment that was for Timothy and the relationship that he had with his father in the faith. And Paul lays his hands on him. In that moment, as Timothy remembers that moment, I'm sure there are times now, as Paul rots in a prison halfway across the Roman Empire, and Timothy sits in Ephesus, that it feels like a distant memory. And Paul says, do not forget, I remind you to fan into flame this gift. We saw similar language in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14. Do not neglect the gift that you have, which was given you by prophecy when the council of elders laid their hands on you. So 1 Timothy 4, it's elders laying their hands on him. And here in 2 Timothy 1, the apostle himself is there laying hands on him. Well, this laying on of hands, it's not magical. It's a confirmation of the work the Spirit of God is doing inside Timothy, in Timothy, and through Timothy. It's a visible external sign of what the Spirit is doing in Timothy. 2 Kings chapter 2, two great prophets, Elijah and Elisha. One has been great, one will be great. They're walking along together. And Elisha, the younger prophet, asks the elder prophet, when you leave, could I have a full portion of God's Spirit? And Elijah says, if you're with me when God takes me. So they're walking along, and sure enough, Elijah is taken to heaven, these chariots of fire. And Elisha's there to see it. But how do we know that Elisha is the heir? Because we're not there to see it. You remember what Elisha takes? Elijah's cloak, his mantle. And he walks up to the Jordan River, and he takes it, and he says, where is the Lord, the God of Elijah? He asks this question, and boom, he strikes the Jordan River, the river parts, and he walks across on dry land. So how do we know that God is with Elisha? Because of what God does in him. And what's the external sign? It's this cloak. The cloak isn't magical. It's a piece of cloth. But it's the visible way that represents the working of God through Elisha. And in a similar way, the laying on of hands isn't a magical ceremony. It's a recognition, a confirmation of what the Spirit is doing. And this reminder comes to Timothy with a particular effect. The Spirit of God in Timothy now, God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. What does the Spirit do in us? Well, one thing the Spirit does not do is make us cowards. That's the word in verse 7, a spirit of cowardice or a spirit of timidity. Rather, the Spirit gives us power, love, self-control. And we see the same kind of thing in the Lord's words to Joshua in Joshua 1 verse 9. Have not I commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened, do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Or Romans 8 verse 15. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. Fear that's before Christ. In Christ there is no fear. For you have received the spirit of adoption as sons by whom we cry, Abba, Father. You're safe, you're courageous, you're protected in the arms of your Father. So let's think about the triad that we have here in 2 Timothy chapter 1. Power, love, self-control. Power. There is nothing that God calls you to do that he does not also give you the power to do. But power, unchecked by love, can be a dangerous thing. So we have the spirit of love as well. Love conditions how we use the strength the Lord gives us. The Spirit never leads us to dominate others. Rather, he leads us to courageously embrace the power that is ours in Christ and then use it to serve others in love. And then he gives us the wisdom to do this in the spirit of self-control. This word is self-discipline or moderation or even discretion. In other words, the Spirit gives us the discretion to use the power that God has given us in love for others. I mean, think about that. There is nothing that God has called you to do that he has not also given you the power to do. And he doesn't give you timidity. He gives you power and love and self-control. Well, do you ever feel timid? I do. I mean, I'm a pretty outspoken guy, but there are times I feel hesitant. I don't like using the word cowardly. Maybe cowardly. Afraid of what people might think. But as we step out into a hostile, threatening world, you can do so knowing that the creator of the universe is at your side, and not only at your side, he is in you, filling you, empowering you. He's empowering you to do what is right, to do it in a loving way, and to do it wisely. So as you engage with non-Christians in a hostile work environment, and you're trying to figure out, you know, what name or pronoun to use with that person at work, the Lord can give you the wisdom, the power, and the love to know how to engage with that situation. As you walk down the hallway of a school filled with people who hate Christ and are hostile to someone who passionately follows Christ, you can know that this Spirit lives in you. As you think about stepping out in faith and moving forward with a step in life that just seems difficult, you can know that God gave you a spirit not of fear, not of cowardice, not of timidity, but of power, love, and self-control. And this is ours in Christ. And this is not some sort of prosperity promise. This is not like us making up something and twisting what God has said. This is what God has given us. This is not what we wish for. This is not what we hope for. This is what God has given us. Remember what is ours in Christ. And this gives us an opportunity to share what is ours in Christ. We'll pick up now in verse 8 and read down through verse 14. So follow along as I read, please. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God who saved us and called us to a holy calling. Not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed a preacher and apostle and teacher, which is why I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me. Follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. By the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the deposit entrusted to you. So Paul reminds us, God has given us a spirit of power, love, and self-control, and he calls us not to be ashamed of the gospel, but to share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. It's the same word, power, that we see in verse 7. By the power of God, we can suffer. So one fruit of what the Spirit does in us is the fruit of being willing to courageously suffer for the gospel. Suffering is not a fun word. Love, that's fun. Power, that's fun. Courage, that's fun. Suffer, not fun. But the good news is we don't do this primarily by looking inside and deciding, I'm going to screw up the courage and I'm going to like this suffering. We do it by remembering who we belong to. First, by looking back to what God has already done. Verse 9 is a reminder of this. He saved us and he called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. Well, what do we contribute to our salvation? I mean, the hymn says, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to the cross I cling. It's not exactly true, because we do bring something. We bring the sin that made the salvation necessary. We bring, in Pilgrim's Progress, this burden of sin. And we need someone to help us with this burden. And God saves us by his grace according to his purpose, and he gave us his grace in Christ before the ages began. Now, we sit here in time. You know, it's August 14th, 2022. And we think in terms of chronology. God, the Creator, sits above time, the creator of time, outside of time, and he sees everything in time. So the gospel comes to us in a real time, in a real place. And we are then responsible to act, to repent, to believe, to trust Christ. But at the same time, God says that he did this before the ages began. Like, it's happening now, but God did it then. That process, begun in eternity past, now comes to us in a real time, in a real place, in a real person. And verse 10 tells us this work has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. So Jesus Christ, the eternal Son, became a human being at a real time, in a real place. And Galatians 4 tells us this happened when the fullness of time had come. God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law. Why did God become a man? To redeem sinners. In love. I mean, he set aside all of his divine rights and made himself, he humbled himself, he became a servant. And a beaten, abused human being. All the things that we're afraid to suffer, he suffered for us. And Paul says, it's by looking to the sufferings of Christ that we can be given the grace, the courage to suffer ourselves. But it's not pointless suffering. It's not sort of some effort to redeem ourselves, because he reminds us that Jesus Christ has already done this. God's plan is redemption. He does it not through our sufferings, but through Christ's. Christ has purchased our freedom. Christ has purchased this love, this power, this self-control. We're all born into this world sinners, deserving to suffer, and yet we don't have to suffer that fate because we can have life through Christ. We're unworthy of God's favor, unworthy of God's love, and we can't earn it, and yet God sets it on us through Christ. Life without Christ is bondage and death. Life in Christ is freedom and life.
Amen.
Eternal life. Oh, friend, if you're here without Christ, would you turn from your sin? Turn from your bondage. Turn from that way of death and trust Jesus. So we look back to what God has done in Christ, and we look forward to what God will do in Christ. So verses 11 and 12 link Paul's preaching and teaching to his suffering in the gospel. But 2 Corinthians 4 tells us, I mean, even if it's really bad suffering, it's light, it's momentary, compared to the eternal weight of glory that's to come. Well, how does this happen? Because verse 12 tells us, I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard, to keep what has been entrusted to me. We have remarkable confidence as Christians because our faith rests in one who is able to keep us. But we have this fascinating tension here, this juxtaposition. Verse 12, I'm convinced that he is able to guard what has been entrusted to me. But then what does Paul say in verse 14? By the Holy Spirit, you guard what has been entrusted to you. So God guards it, God keeps it, but he calls us to guard it, us to keep it. I mean, this is one of the great tensions of the Christian life. God ordains the ends and the means. Someone gets sick. Well, what do? James 5 tells us we pray. We pray for that person that they might be healed. So we pray, hopefully without ceasing. And who heals that person? God. Like, when and if that person is healed, God is the one healing that person. What is the means that God uses? He uses our prayers. Now, he doesn't need our prayers, but he uses these means. What about when we share the gospel? I mean, Hebrews 7 tells us that God is able to save to the uttermost, anyone who draws near, God will save. How does he do this? Romans 10. How are they calling him in whom they have never heard? And how are they here without someone preaching? So God is saving, but he's using human means. He's using our efforts to share the gospel. And similarly here, God will keep us, but the way he does this is through our keeping what has been entrusted to us. Well, how do we do this? Verse 13, we follow the pattern of sound words you've heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. We keep our lives tethered to pattern. Well, to say I'm not much of a seamster, is a vast understatement. I have sewn on a few buttons in my life. I have taped up with masking tape or scotch tape some hems that were coming out. But I don't really sew. I have members of my family who can sew pretty well. I'm not one of them. But if you are creating something, unless you're really, really good, you're going to do what? You're going to follow a pattern. And the pattern kind of tells you what to do and where to put things. And if you don't follow the pattern, the garment turns out wonky. You know, one leg is shorter than the other, or just like it sits on you weird. And same thing is true for a house. We call the pattern a blueprint. The blueprint tells us what goes where, and if you don't follow the blueprint, if you've been in a house, I've been in some that were clearly built without a blueprint, and they didn't fit together quite right. You walked into one room, and it was this high, and the different room was this high. This is true for putting together Legos. You follow the plan, and you get what you're looking for, right? You get the fire engine. If you don't follow the plan, you get something weird. It's true for any number of things, and this is true for the Christian life as well. As we walk the Christian life, we are following a pattern. We are weaving a garment of sorts. And this garment is the tapestry of our lives. So as we weave, we follow the pattern. Seek first the kingdom of God. That's where we start. And we orient our lives around that pattern. Love your neighbor as yourself. We follow the pattern. We seek to conform our lives to that pattern. Live out the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. We connect ourselves to the pattern. So we walk through life and we're following this pattern. And we're seeing, okay, what is the revealed will of God for me as his child? What does he call me to do? But then we're going along, and we're like, oh, I'm good. And we set the pattern aside. And we keep on sowing. And then we look back, and what happens? The seam is off. And our lives are out of line. We've fallen short. We've gotten out of the way. And so what do? We have to take out that seam ripper and rip up all those stitches and go back and start where we begin. The Bible calls that what? Repentance. We follow the pattern and we get off and we got to tear out those entrenched patterns, those seams in our lives to get back on. We have to follow the pattern that God has laid out for us. It's a pattern lived perfectly by Jesus, followed imperfectly by us. But we follow the pattern. And as we follow this pattern, God keeps us. I mean, we're following. We think it's us, but it's God the whole time. It's like that kid who's learning to walk. And mom and dad are there, and they're stumbling along, and they're going to trip and they fall. And who's making sure they don't totally trip? Well, mom or dad, because they're right there. They're keeping them the whole time. And they're like, oh, I'm Mr. Independent. I got it all figured out. I'm two. You know, I'm on top of the world. I'm 2 years old, and I'm big, and I'm bad. But the minute mom or dad is gone, it's like, look out, right? And God walks, God keeps us, and we're like these stumbling toddlers, just like blindly making our way through life, and yet God keeps us. And this is where our confidence comes from, knowing that he who began a good work in us will bring it to completion. You will fall, you will trip, you will stumble. We're a lot worse than that toddler, and yet God will keep us. There are a lot of seams in our lives that we've got to rip out along the way, a lot of patterns that God has to work out of us. And as we live out our responsibility to follow this pattern, to keep, to guard what God has entrusted to us, someone's God acting. Because he tells us, even as we do this by the Holy Spirit who lives within us. I mean, even when we're acting, God is acting through us. So we share what God has given us, and then we celebrate what God does through the body of Christ. Let's pick up now in verse 15, and we'll read down through verse 18. You are aware, Paul says, that all who are in Asia turn away from me, among whom are Phygellus and Hermogenes. May the Lord grant mercy to the household of Onesiphorus, for he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chains. But when he arrived in Rome, he searched for me earnestly and found me. May the Lord grant him to find mercy from the Lord on that day. And you well know all the service he rendered at Ephesus. Paul is suffering, prison. And the heat of this suffering, of this trial, has caused some to walk away. You are aware, verse 15, that all who are in Asia turned away from me, among whom are Phygellus and Hermogenes. Paul grieves the loss of these fair-weather friendships. I mean, the first people we meet here are those who think that when the going gets tough, the tough get out of town. There's a group that has abandoned Paul. There are a couple of ringleaders, Phygellus and Hermogenes. Former friends and former allies, and they now abandoned him. Now, what's not clear here is whether they've also walked away from Christ, or whether they've just walked away from Christ's servant. Sometimes Paul says this person abandoned the faith. That's not what he says about them. He says they walked away from me. They abandoned him. They pulled their moral and relational support at a time when Paul badly needs it. He's under duress. He's cast into prison. I mean, maybe these guys were drawn to Paul when his ministry was growing and fruitful. You know, when the church in Ephesus, when he was there for over 2 years and it was really flourishing. Perhaps they enjoyed the notoriety that came from being associated with the apostle, with the well-known apostle. But now that Paul is in prison, they turn away. Paul is at the most intense battle of his life, waiting for execution, and these former allies have abandoned him. But in the midst of that discouragement, Paul remembers another friend, Onesiphorus. And the memory of this friend refreshes him. In contrast to the flaky former friends, Onesiphorus, verse 16 tells us, was not ashamed of Paul's chains. In fact, when the going got tough, Onesiphorus ran toward trouble for Paul. So Onesiphorus arrives in Rome, and he does a lot better than, you know, Jesus' disciples. Remember when Jesus died and his disciples abandoned him? The Gospels tell us that there was one disciple who looked on from a distance, that Peter denies Christ, and there's one, John, who does the best of anyone, but he sort of waits to see what happens. He just watches, and Jesus dies alone. Onesiphorus, though, this dude is a dude. He goes to Rome, and he walks into this Roman city, the capital of this pagan empire, and he says, "Hey, I'm here to see a man. His name is Paul. He's my friend. Could you help me find him?" And they're like, "Oh, well, we know Paul. Paul's on death row. He's on death row for believing what you believe, for preaching the gospel that you claim." And Onesiphorus says, "Yeah, that's the guy. That's the one I'm here to see." And he travels, and when he arrives, he searched earnestly for me and found me. It wasn't easy. Like, Paul's suffering, and some people run. Onesiphorus doesn't have to suffer, but he looks for him, and then he suffers with him. He searched earnestly, with great effort, to find him and be with him. But this wasn't new for Onesiphorus. I mean, he's been doing this before. Verse 18, "You know well all the service he rendered at Ephesus." So, back in Ephesus, Timothy knows this guy, and he's a faithful member of that church in Ephesus. And now he's far from Ephesus, and he's in Rome, and he's continuing the same kind of life-giving ministry. And what's the effect of this ministry in Paul's life? Verse 16, "He often refreshed me." I mean, it's easy to sit here almost 2,000 removed from Paul and imagine that Paul is some kind of machine or automaton. You know, like, suffering back then was easy. I mean, it's really hard, because I feel it. But for Paul, it was easy, because back then, it was just, you know, it was easier. And so Paul didn't feel it in the same way, and he was just sort of this machine marching through life. He suffered stoically in prison. The temptation that I would feel if I were suffering to make me walk away from the faith, Paul didn't feel that, and so he never was tempted to walk away from Jesus. When friends walked away from Paul in hard times, that was just something that happened back then. And so it's just words on a page. I mean, it didn't have a real debilitating, devastating effect in his life. How do you terrible? But I cannot help but see Paul's experience here as a celebration of the work of God through the body of Christ. Because what does Paul focus on? He is refreshed. I mean, he's honest about the grief. So on the one hand, we have a large number of people, all who are in Asia. Two leaders mentioned by name. He's honest about the betrayal of friends. He's not fixated on it. He doesn't live there. It's like he points briefly to it. "This happened to me." And then he soaks his soul in the faithful friendship of Onesiphorus. A while back, I was listening to an author of a book and a podcast. He's being interviewed, and it's bestseller, highly rated all over Amazon. He was talking about, you know, it's like hundreds or thousands of five-star reviews of his book. But not everyone loves his book. And so there are a handful of one-star reviews of people who hated his book. And he made the mistake of going onto Amazon and looking at reviews. And he was looking through, and it's like, pretty good. He's like, "Well, who are these people?" And he made the mistake of reading this handful of people who hated his book. And then what does he think about those people? I mean, thousands of people who love it! And these people hate it. And what do we do? It's easy to meditate on what's broken today. It's hard to soak our souls in what's good. But Paul says, "I know I have believed. And I am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me." It's like, it's ours to keep. It's entrusted to us. He will keep it. I'm convinced of it. And God gave us a spirit not of fear, not of timidity, but of power and love and self-control. Oh, my friends, if we soak our souls in the life-giving truth of the gospel, we lean into life-giving relationships, God will refresh our souls. So be encouraged. Be encouraged at how God is at work. Be encouraged at the work that God is doing in you. At the seams God is ripping out of your life. At the patterns He is building in of Christ's likeness. Be encouraged at the work that God is doing through you as you encourage others. The work He is doing around you. And then as you are refreshed at the work that God does in you, be that friend. When you see that brother or that sister that needs to be refreshed, earnestly seek them out. Run to Rome. Embrace their suffering. Breathe out the life-giving grace of the gospel. Remember what God has done for you and share it with others. Remember the gifts that are ours, not just ours individually, but ours in the body of Christ. And as we walk through, we will stumble. But this is how God works. This is how God keeps us. And Paul says we embrace this life. It's sometimes a life of suffering, but it's a life we can embrace confidently in power and love and self-control. All of this is ours in Christ, and we can walk through, and when we're weak, we can remain convinced that He is able to keep and guard us against that day. Let's take a moment now and respond to the Word of God in repentance and faith. I'll give you a moment to talk with God personally, and then we'll close this time in prayer. Let's talk to Him now. Father, we thank You for the grace that is ours in Christ Jesus. Thank You for saving us, for calling us to a holy calling, but also promising that what You begin in us, You will keep. Lord, I pray that You will help us live in courage and faith and love. God, that we will refresh one another in the gospel. And that when You call us, like Paul, to face difficulty for the sake of the gospel, God, that we will run, knowing that within us the Holy Spirit is the one who keeps us, that we will run to that suffering for the sake of Christ. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we are going to come now to a reminder of our Lord's suffering for us. We're going to come to the table of the Lord in communion. The bread, which represents the body of Christ, broken for us for our sin. And the cup, the blood of Christ shed, washes white as snow. If you're here, you know God through faith in Jesus Christ. You've been baptized and are a follower of Christ. I would love for you to take part in this meal with us. Now, not everyone will, and that's fine, because some of us are either not yet followers or are still working through that. But we're going to come in just a minute. We're going to sing as we do this. We're going to sing of Christ's sufferings, and we're going to remember it together in this meal. And if you come, you can come up the center aisle, then back out, and then enter through the kind of the outside aisle. That would be great. I take the bread and the cup, just hang on to it for a minute, and then we'll all await, and we will eat and drink together at the end. Would you stand, please? We'll sing together as we prepare to eat.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us, and we remember and remember
He said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it, in remembrance of me." Then in the same manner, Jesus took the cup. He said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Yes. Thanks, Joes. You can drop your cup in the trash can. We'd appreciate that as you go. We have snacks available, water. We'd love for you to hang out, get to know one another, experience a little bit of what it means to be a part of the body of Christ, maybe even refresh someone who's discouraged, and just build one another up in faith. We're going to go in just a minute. We're going to break 15 or 20 minutes, and then we will regather ourselves here, spend some time in prayer together. We would love for you to stay for that if you can. "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we could ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout